Lord on this morning. Hallelujah. We get to come together and give the Lord glory, give him honor, give him praise. Hallelujah. Did you come with your praise on today? Did you come with your praise? I came with a praise inside of me. Hallelujah. Come on and let us pray. Thank you, God, for this day. Thank you for waking us up, God. Thank you for safe travel here, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for being in the building where two or three are gathered. You're in our midst, God. So, God, we come before you with adoration. We come before you with thanksgiving. Hallelujah. We come before you ready to give you all the glory and honor you deserve, Lord. You've been so good to us. You've been so kind to us. You've been so faithful to us, God. You've been so loving and forgiving, God. Hallelujah. God, we're grateful. We're grateful in our hearts. We're grateful in our minds. We are grateful with the fruit of our lips because you are faithful. Hallelujah. You are awesome. You are just. Hallelujah. You are sovereign, God. Hallelujah. And you reign forever. You reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. We thank you that you have met us here. And God, that you, your glory will go before us. Hallelujah. Hide us and show your glory. Be glorified in this place. Be magnified in this place. Be exalted in this place. Hallelujah. We lift our praise even now. We lift our praise even now. Hallelujah. 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 You are great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. We honor you, Lord. Hallelujah. And we are expected, hallelujah, for you to do great things in this place today. Hallelujah. Have your way in every heart and every mind, God. Have your way. Holy name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. 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 We're gonna sing this hallelujah chant unto the Lord. Hallelujah. It's real easy. Hallelujah. Just repeat after me.
You are the beginning and the end.
You're the beginning and the end.
faithful. He's so faithful. He's made ways for me time after time. I'm sure you can agree. I'm sure he's made ways in your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So God, we lift our hands in gratefulness. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. For every way you've made. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. I love this song because we get to brag, we get to boast on our God who has made ways for us time after time after time after time. Hallelujah. But for those of you who are facing a mountain right now and he hasn't moved it just yet, what is your posture? What is your stance? How are you waiting? Are you waiting with your arms folded, upset? Or are we standing with arms lifted, ready to receive? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I like to sing this praise. Hallelujah. Repeat after me. Hands go up.
Hands go up.
Praise gets loud.
Praise gets loud.
All that you need.
All that you need.
It can happen right
it
now.
It can happen right
hands
now.
Go up. All over
hands
the house.
Go up.
Praise gets loud.
Praise gets loud.
All that you need.
All that you need.
It can happen right
it
now.
It can happen right
hands
now.
Go
around. You keep on making a way. Oh, you keep on making a way. So I trust in you, I depend on you, cause you keep on making a way. Ways out of no ways, you keep on making a way. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. You keep on making a way. Where would I be without the grace of God? Cause you keep on making a way. You keep on, you keep on, keep on. You keep on making a way. Yeah. You move mountains. Walls to fall, by your power, you perform miracles. There is nothing, nothing that's impossible. As we're standing here, only because you've made a way. Now, if he's made ways for you, come on, give him glory in this room. Oh, that's good for the song, but I said if he's made a way for you, a way in the wilderness, come on, you didn't know how you were going to get out of that grief, but he made a way. Come on, you didn't know how he was going to move the mountain, but he made a way. Come on, you didn't know how he was going to handle that situation, but you woke up one morning and realized that my God had made a way when I didn't know where it was going to come from. I couldn't find my exit. My God made a way for me. We thank you, Lord. You're a God who makes ways out of no ways. Makes ways out of no ways. Yeah. We love you, Lord. You've been so faithful to us. We thank you that you stick closer to us than a brother. We thank you, Lord. But there is no one who can do what you do. You've been so near, so kind, so gracious to us. We thank you that you have remained with us. Everyone else could leave, Father, you stayed. You made a promise to never leave us nor forsake us. So we give you glory for that. Come on, lift your hands right there, church, and just begin to tell him thank you. Come on, out of your own mouth. Tell him thank you because he has remained with you. Thank you, Lord, for sticking around. Yeah. Church, if you know us, sing it out. Say, I've seen.
I've seen a lot of things and I've been a lot of places.
I've seen people come and go.
I've seen people come and go. I've been through a lot of changes.
But one thing.
One thing I can always say. Is you've been here every step.
Is that your testimony this morning, that he's been with you every step of the way? We thank you, Lord. Say, I have heard a lot of things.
I have heard a lot said, and sometimes we leave the wrong things.
I've made choices I regret.
I've made choices I regret, and I doubt it's your mercy.
But there is one. That you don't change,
you don't change on me, won't give up on me. I remind my soul that you don't let go, no, you remain.
Come on, some of you ought to just remind yourself this morning that he has stayed with you. Whoa, I have heard
a lot of said and sometimes
I made choices I regret.
And I've doubted your mercy.
But there is one thing, just one thing,
one thing I can always say. Is you've been here
every step of the way. You've been here, Lord. And I'm so grateful, so thankful that you don't change.
Don't change on me.
You won't give up.
Go.
You don't let go. But you're still here with me. Oh God, I'm grateful. I'm really thankful, 'cause you've had so many reasons to leave. But you're still here with me. Oh God, I'm morning. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no lie you won't kick down, wall you won't tear down, coming after me. Lift your hands, church. Thank you for staying. Thank you for staying. Even when I tried to leave, we tried to walk away. You never gave up on us. You never gave up on us. When we weren't faithful, we told you we'd do something. When we didn't, we weren't faithful. You stayed faithful to us. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for never leaving. No, there's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. Yeah. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. You're coming after me, always coming after me, always coming after me, always coming after me. You're always coming after me, always coming after me. Tears me down, fights with, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself, all the old, ever, reckless love. Father, we thank you for your love. You never leave nor forsake us, that you remain, you stay close. We thank you for what you've done for us. You've changed our lives forever. As we continue in this time of worship, we're going to take communion as we continue to remember what Jesus has done for us. If you did not receive a communion cup when you came in, you can raise your hand. Someone will be by to hand you one. As we're getting that together, there's a couple of things we want you to know about communion. One is that here at Anthem Church, we have open communion, meaning that you do not have to be a member of this church as long as you are a member of the church. So if you have confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that you may be visiting here, you're more than welcome to partake in communion with us. Second thing is, if you have little ones, children with you, we're going to leave it up to your discretion if you want them to participate in communion or not. You know your child better than we do. If you feel like they have a relationship with Jesus and you want them to partake in communion, we'll leave that up to you. The Bible tells us that we should come into this moment not haphazardly, but as we remember what Jesus did, that this is something that is holy. We ought to come to the communion table with a clear conscience. Now, here's the great news. Is that if there is something on your conscience, if there is something in your heart that you need forgiveness of or to repent of, you don't have to kill a bird or a goat, but you can just simply talk to your Father. So we're going to leave you this space. We're going to give you just a moment to clear your heart, to clear your mind as we prepare for communion. So if you need to ask the Lord for forgiveness of anything, if you need to repent of anything, now is the time to do it. Jesus, we thank you that we can come to you for forgiveness. The same night that he was about to be betrayed, Jesus gathered his disciples for one last supper. And he gathered them together and he took the bread. He blessed it. He broke it. And he gave it to them. He said, "This is my body, which will be broken for you. Take ye and eat all of it." Let us take and eat. As you open the next compartment that has the juice. Oh, I need nails. Oh, I got it. Amen. As Pastor Christian say, with a mighty thumb. So in the same manner, he took wine. Now, this is just juice, so you're okay. He gave it to him. He said, "This is my blood. The same blood that will wash away your sins. The same blood that will wash you white as snow. The same blood that will be shed for your healing. This is it. My blood that will be shed for you." He said, "Take and drink." Let us take and drink. Now, come on, can we give him glory for what he has done for us? Now, normally, this would be the time where we would celebrate the blood. And I don't know about you, but I'm grateful for the blood. Anybody grateful for the blood? Thank you. But today, I want us to celebrate the bread. Jesus said, "This is my body." And then later on, we learned that we are called the body of Christ. Anybody grateful to be in the body? He took the bread. He said, "This is my body." Jesus did three things. He took bread, which is mundane. Bread was just regular. It was about the most regular thing that you could have. And some of you might look at yourselves and say, "Well, I'm not special. There's nothing really great about me." Or you may look at the things that you do in your life, the mundane things, how you raise your family, how you treat your spouse, how you live in your workplace. And you may think of that as a simple, mundane, regular thing. But the Bible says that Jesus blessed the body. He blessed the bread. He blessed the regular thing. So congratulations, you've been blessed by God. In the normal things that you do in your regular day-to-day, you don't have to have a super big ministry. You don't have to have a microphone. You've been blessed. You are special. You are a part of the kingdom. If you are in the body, you've been blessed. Then it says he broke it. Being broken doesn't feel good all the time. And some of you may be feeling like you are broken, that you just can't seem to put it together. But I'm here to remind you that being broken is not something of the devil. Jesus broke the bread. He broke it because sometimes things have to get out of the way. We have to be reminded that we are in the hands of God. And also, he did not break it and leave it. But the Bible says that he broke it and he gave it. What Jesus wants to do through his people, through those who are considered the body of Christ, He doesn't break us just to leave us, but he breaks us, he shapes us, he molds us, he takes things away, he takes things apart, he puts us in a position to be given. We have been called to make impact wherever we go. Go and make disciples of the nation. He gave us to the world. So he blesses us, he breaks us, but he gives us to the world to go and lead those who do not know him to know him. So do me a favor. I know we celebrate the blood and we love the blood because it has cleansed our sins and it has washed us new. But can we thank God today that we are his body, that we've been blessed? Come on. Thank him because he's blessed you. Come on, thank him because he's blessed you. And it didn't feel good, but bless him because he broke you. Bless him because he moved some things out of the way. Come on. Bless him because he made you different to be used. Now let's give him glory that he is giving us away. Come on. Give him glory because he is giving us to the world, that we are called to lead people to know him and make him known, that everywhere we go, in the simple things, by the way we raise our family, by the way we raise our children, by the way we love our spouses, by the way we live in the workplace, that we are making him known. He has given us away. Jesus, we thank you for this time to remember that you have taken little old us and made us into something special. We bless you and we remember. Come on, one more time. Clap those hands. Give him glory if you're grateful. Before you have a seat, won't you greet your neighbor? Let them know you're so glad to see them this morning. Come on, tell them they look good. Say, I'm glad to see you. If it's somebody you don't know, it's okay. Just say, I'm glad to see you. Amen.
Good evening, Anthem.
Hey, Anthem.
How you guys doing this morning? Good, good, good. My name is Omar. I'm the Spanish pastor for Iglesia Anthem.
Yes, and my name is Reese. I am the Director of Administration and Communications here at this house, Anthem Church.
And we want to take our time to actually acknowledge our online community, yes. Whether they're watching through YouTube or Facebook. If they go ahead, just type it on the chat. Tell us where you're watching from.
Even if you're watching in replay land, too.
Yes.
Don't forget about that. Replay land.
Uh-huh. Even if you're watching the replay.
So. All right. And not just the online people, but everybody that is inside of this house, thank you so much for spending this moment with us. Thank you so much for being in the building. Now, between me and you, we have some very special people in the house. There are VIPs, and that is our first-time guest. So let's get loud for our first-time guest. All right. Now, if this is your first time in a building, there is a card in front of you, okay? There's a QR code. You can scan that with your smartphone. If you don't have your phone, not a problem, because there's a card in there. Fill it out. It's a super short form. Meet us in the lobby in about 40 minutes, and we just want to show you some Anthem love, you know? And we have some free church merch just for saying thank you for spending this morning with us. So, yes.
Now, I don't know if you guys know what time it is.
It's my favorite time of the service.
I think it's mine, too.
What time is that, you all? That is offering time. Yes. So let me tell you why it is my favorite. Because here at Anthem Church, our mission is simple. It's to lead people to know Christ and make him known. And one way that we do that is through our offering, okay? So on the screen behind me, there's a QR code that is going to pop up. Take out your phone, scan it, and you can give online, whether it's one time or if you would like to set up a recurring gift, you can do that. If you don't have your phone, that's not a problem because there are some envelopes in front of you. Fill it out, stuff it with your cash, check, or money order, drop it in the containers before you leave the auditorium, and we'll handle the rest.
Yes. So we got a couple announcements that we want to share with you guys today.
I got the exciting one. All right. So September 17th is our 3-year anniversary. Let's give it up for Anthem and our 3-year anniversary. Now, I have a fun fact, okay? So we launched 3 years ago in the middle of a global pandemic online. All right. Now, I want you to take a moment and just look at the back. Look how full we are, y'all. I don't know about you, but that's something to celebrate. And we are going to be in the building September 17th, that's a Sunday, to celebrate Anthem.
Yes.
All right.
So September 22nd, we got a special event going on. Actually, we got our 10-year pastoral celebration. And on that, so we're going to be celebrating the Hamster family for their 10 years of service here and just being able to just serve us with their very best.
Yes.
And you're all invited. You're all welcome. And just help us just celebrate our pastors. Amen?
Amen.
That's going to be a Friday at 7 p.m. There's more information online.
Woo!
Yes. last but not least, I don't know if you guys know how the weather's slightly changing. It's getting a little cooler at night.
My favorite
season. Because it's called
fall
season. Here at Anthem, we have our fall discipleship season, which we are excited about.
I am so excited about that.
Because it's an awesome opportunity for every single one of us to now grow in Christ.
Yes,
and
yes.
We got various ways where we could do that here in Anthem. We got our freedom tracks. We have our crews. And then we are actually launching our Mosaic School of Ministry.
Woo!
Yes.
Wait, now I signed up. Did you sign up?
Because I'm signed up.
I'm
not mistaken, there's over 100 people.
Yes, it is.
That signed up for the Mosaic School of Ministry. I don't know if you're excited about that, but I am.
I am too.
And there's also another one that's kind of dear to my heart.
What is it, Omar?
Could they guess? Is that possible?
Let's guess. Iglesia.
You guys got it. I'm excited. If you guys have a family member that speaks Spanish, or you speak Spanish and you want to be part of it, we also have our Iglesia Anthem crew launching this September as well.
Yes.
Now, can we all just like bow down our heads, close our eyes, and pray for our tithes and offering? Father, we want to thank you that one more time.
Yes, Father.
For the opportunity that you have given us to just sow into your kingdom. Father, we want to ask you, Father, to bless this seed, Father. Let it reach countless lives, Father God. Father, let it provide opportunities for people to just be able to give you the glory, give you the honor, Father God, and make you known in every nation and every tongue, Father God. So we want to thank you, Father, for that one more time. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now, if you could just go ahead and just turn your attention to the screen. We got a video coming up, and it's going to let you know a little bit more information about what's going on our fall discipleship season. And after that, you're going to hear the voice of our very own executive pastor, Christian Washington.
All right.
Why do you think it's important for believers to be intentional about growing in how they handle their money?
Well, looking at it from the aspect of if they come to church on Sunday to break generational curses, imagine coming another night and you're breaking financial curses, because your spiritual walk could be great, but if your life doesn't have reflection that people see to say, wow, God is doing this in my life financially, not saying we're chasing to be rich or chasing money, but if we're using wisdom and making financial decisions, people can see that, and it becomes an intentional way of spreading the gospel without even knowing it.
That's really great. You and your wife have been leading Financial Peace here for a while now. How does it make you feel knowing that you've been a part of helping people grow in their relationship with Jesus and their finances. Do you have any particular stories you want to share?
I probably feel honored to be a part of what we do here at Anthem, just like everybody else. People here are blessing me with the things that they do, whether it's on Sunday or another day. So I'm just paying it forward, just like God has called us to do. As far as like a particular story, I was, you know, one participant, they brought in, I want to say 9 credit cards, and we do what's called a plissectomy every week, and they're allowed to go ahead and cut up credit cards. And one participant cut up 9 credit cards, and seeing that stronghold, that bondage broke off of them and how happy they were, it's rewarding. It makes it worth it. Just like what, you know, people do here on Sundays or other days in the small, in the groups and all that, it just makes it worth it.
Yeah, that's good. So financial peace is a part of Freedom Track here. And Freedom Track is about to start here in the next few weeks. Some people may be apprehensive to joining not only financial peace, but any of the other classes. What would you say to encourage someone to take that next step and join Freedom Track?
If for no other reason, give it a try. Any part of Freedom Track, not just financial peace, but the other ones, no matter what, if you try it and you leave the same, no harm, no foul, you just lost a couple of evenings. But imagine what could happen if you go and you participate and you literally change the course of your whole life from sacrificing coming to something for 8 or 9 classes. So it's a win-win situation, or no harm, no foul, but you won't know unless you go.
Hey, give it up for financial peace, you guys. Give it up for financial peace. So cool. I think I'm joining financial peace. Plissectomy, I've never heard that term before. It's pretty dope. All right, you guys, so plenty of opportunity. We still got a couple of more weeks for you to sign up for the Freedom Track classes or crew or School of Mosaic Ministry. So we're pretty, pretty excited about it. Good morning to everybody. My name is Christian. Hola, hola. Hey, it was cool seeing Omar and Reese up here. They look like they're brother and sister. I thought they were going to speak Spanish the whole time. It was going to be cool. Nope. So for those that don't know me, yes, my name is Christian. I have the pleasure of serving as your executive pastor and a part of the teaching team here at Anthem. I do want to recognize our first-time guest one more time. If you are a first-time guest, you might just wave your hand just like this, if you don't mind. Hey, 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 hey. Yes! So good to see you guys. It is truly our honor to have you here this morning. We would love to meet you right outside these doors in about 30-ish minutes. That'd be fantastic. Hey, we are in the middle, dead smack in the middle of our series called Blind Spots. How has it been for you? It's been all right? Yeah? Okay. Y'all gonna talk to me this morning? All right. All right. Yes, it's been cool. So we are dead smack in the middle of it. It's been 3 weeks so far. Pastor Sam has really been breaking it off. This particular week, this is week number 4, so I'll take this one. And then next week, Pastor Sam will be back. I know he's itching to get back for week number 5. We're going to conclude out the series. What is Blind Spots all about? You may have the question in the back of your head if this is your first time here in this particular series. Blind Spots, we're recognizing that our vision, we have blind spots, not necessarily in our eyes, but it's the eyes of our heart. So over those past couple of weeks, we've been uncovering all of these hidden things inside of our heart so we can grow better spiritually and see better spiritually as well. So it's been really cool. Do this for me. Go ahead and stand to your feet. We are going to go to the book of Numbers. The book of Numbers, the 22nd chapter. The Numbers is in the Old Testament. How often do y'all read from Numbers? It's like, you know, it's not necessarily on our reading plan, you know. and those that don't necessarily like math, it's like, whoa, I'm staying away from that. But Numbers is a really cool book. I think it's going to really speak to our hearts about some vision that God is trying to develop inside of us. Before we jump into the text, can we just take a couple of seconds with grateful hearts and just give God our best praise? Is that cool? I just got, man, a worship did something for me this morning. And it was like, yes, Lord, you have been faithful. You have remained. If that has been your testimony, can y'all just take the next 10 seconds and give God your best worship and your best praise? If you don't mind, just for a second. Because he's been good. He's been so good. He's been so good. Oh, my goodness. In the times that I let go of his hand, he kept holding on to mine. And the times that I turned my back on him, he was right there by my side. God is faithful. He is faithful. Yes, he is. So right here in Numbers, you guys, the 22nd chapter and the 12th verse, I'm going to give you the Clef Note version of this. Anybody love Clef Notes? In my old heads out there, they used to have Clef Notes. You don't have to read the whole thing. Just give me the Clef Notes. Right here before verse number 12, you have a scenario that's happening. Two people in particular. You have Balak. Somebody say Balak. He is the king of the Moabites. And then you have Bilhah. Somebody say Bilhah. Bilhah, he is the prophet of prophets. He's known around the nations to be a dude that just is in touch with God and gives prophecies that's very accurate. So what had happened was these mean people from Egypt are coming now towards Moab. And the king of the Moabites is sending out for this prophet to say, hey, come and curse these people because we don't want them to take our land. So I know in the past, whoever you cursed, they were cursed. And whoever you blessed, they were blessed. So come and do this for us. Please, will you do that? So this is Bilhah going to God and asking him for permission to actually do what the king of the Moabites wants him to do. Verse number 12, here we go. But God told Bilhah, do not go with him. Very simple. You are not to curse these people, for they have been blessed. The next morning, Bilhah got up and told Balak officials, go on home. The Lord will not allow me to come out and play. So the Moabite officials returned to King Balak and reported Bilhah refused to come with us. Then Balak tried again. This time, he sent a larger number of even more distinguished officials and those that he sent the first time. Then they went to Balaam and delivered this message to him. This is what Balak, son of Zippor, says. Please don't let anything stop you from coming to help me. I will pay you very well and do whatever you tell me to do. Just come and curse these people. But Balaam responded to Balak's messengers. Even if Balak were to give me his palace full of silver and gold, I will be powerless to do anything against the will of the Lord, my God. Somebody say, my God.
My God.
Yep, the will of the Lord, my God. But stay here just for one night and let me see if the Lord has anything else to say to me. That night, God came to Bilhah and told him, since these men have come for you, get up and go with them, but do only what I tell you to do. So the next morning, Bilhah got up, saddled his donkey, started off towards Moab. But God got angry with Bilhah for going. So he sent the angel of the Lord to stand in the road to block his way. As Bilhah and two servants were riding, Bilhah's donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand. The donkey bought it off the road into a field, but Bilhah beat it and turned it back unto the road. All right, so this is, again, the Cliff Note version. What happened after this is it happened two more times, okay? So the donkey saw the angel of the Lord. It tried to go the other way. Then Bilhah smacked it around and got upset and said, keep going. Jump down to verse 28. Then the Lord gave the donkey the ability to speak. What is this, Shrek? No, this is the Bible. Yes. He gave them the ability to speak. What have I done to you that deserve your beating me 3 times? He asked Balaam. You have made me look like a fool, Balaam shouted. If I had a sword with me, I would kill you. But I am the same donkey that you've ridden all your life. The donkey answered, have I ever done anything like this before? No, Balaam said. Then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the middle of the roadway with a drawn sword in his hand. Balaam bowed his head and fell face down to the ground. The title for today's message is Blinded by Secret Desires. Blinded by secret desires. Don't look anywhere. Just keep your eyes on me. Eyes on me. Blinded by secret desires. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. We pray that you show us our secret desires that's in our blind spots. We don't want them anymore. Bring it to our line of sight so you can deal with it. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Go and take your seat. Go and take your seat. Take your seat. Cool. And 2 quick little shout-outs. Can we make some noise for the people that's joining us online? Hey, thank you guys so much for joining us online. And the second shout-out, our pastors who were celebrating in a couple of weeks. It is their 10-year pastoral anniversary. We're really excited. They're super duper modest, you guys, but we always like to give honor where honor is due. But they're not here this morning because they off, you know, enjoying their good lives. So for those that don't know what Pastor Sam looked like, he looks kind of like me, you know. I'm just playing. He's much more handsome. Yeah. All right, you guys. Hey, I got a quick little story just to lean into this. Just a quick little disclaimer. As you can see, kind of like by the title, this is going to be a message that may not necessarily be a shouting type message, but I think it's going to be a message that we really need. It's going to speak to our hearts. Is that cool? All right. So with this, I mentioned this in a prayer meeting a couple of weeks ago about this experience, but I think it's befitting for me to throw it out to you now. So a couple of weeks ago, I had a wisdom tooth removed. Has anybody had your wisdom teeth removed? God bless you. It is quite the experience. So me at 42, this is my first time having this wisdom tooth removed. Before this appointment, I went in and I did not have any issues. I didn't have any major issues with my teeth. So I thought it was just going to be a quick get in, get out. They don't charge me a whole bunch of money. You know what I'm saying? You know, I don't need no extra deductibles and stuff like that. Let's just do this cleaning and get about my business. So I went in. They had the examination. Everything was going okay. And then they did the x-rays. They looked in places that they can't see with the naked eye. And everything was going okay. And then they got towards the end of the examination. And they were looking at the x-rays and said, aha. She had her whole hand in my mouth. And I was like, aha? what are we talking about? So as she pulled out her hand, she mentioned to me that, hey, Christian, Mr. Washington, I see you have a huge cavity right here in one of your wisdom teeth. Before then, I've went into other medical professionals, and they've noticed some dark spots on that particular tooth. And they're like, oh, it's cool. You know, if it's not bothering you, you know, just keep on going. You're straight. So I thought it was going to be kind of like the same thing. So I treat dentists more or less the same way that I treat mechanics. I don't trust them. All right. God bless you if you are a trustworthy mechanic. Please holler at me because I need one, all right? But I don't trust them because they're always trying to bring up stuff. And I don't even know if you're fixing the right stuff. But you want to charge me an arm and a leg. I treat the dentist the same way. So me, being me, I asked the dentist, hey, Miss Doctor, do we actually need to take this tooth out? And she said, we'll have to, but if I leave it in there, it's just going to get worse. And it's big enough now where infection is going to really set in inside of this tooth, and not only will it affect this particular tooth, but it will affect the other teeth inside of your mouth. Matter of fact, then it'll start jacking up your gums and you have all of this gum disease and you know, your teeth start falling out and then you're in here every other week. I was like, okay, can we, so you want to do this today, right? So I got the picture really fast, but what God was showing to me in that instance, and I believe what he's trying to lay out for us today, is that there are some spiritual cavities inside of our wisdom teeth that needs to be addressed. And see, here's the thing, is that it's not impacting you today. No pain is coming your way. No issues is coming your way today, and you can't really see it all the time. But if you don't address it today, infection will set up for you in the future. And it won't just be infection for you, but it will affect everything else around you. It will affect other people around you, other circles that you're attached to, your family, your job, if you don't deal with it today. I said, okay, thank you, Lord. And then I had to think about how did I get these cavities in the first place? Well, I'm one where I like cakes and pies, you know? I like my Snickers, I like my Babe Ruths, you know what I'm saying? Make some noise if you like paydays, you know? Yeah, baby. Y'all don't like paydays? I smash paydays. King size. I get down like that. Yes, I do. So with that, he had to bring notice to how did I get these cavities in the first place. I will eat those. I have a sweet tooth, and I will eat those things, and I'll call myself cleaning up those places that need to go away, but it's residual stuff that stay on my teeth that I can't see sometimes, that I need a professional to come in and clean it up. And I hadn't seen a dentist in about 2 to 3 years. So how can I expect for all that gunk to be left away and not have a bigger cavity? What am I trying to say today? I know that you've been trying to clean up yourself by yourself, but God is the God of X-ray vision. God is the one that sees the hidden things of your heart, and he is the one that will unearth some things so he can extract what needs to be extracted so the infection don't set in and it won't jack up your life. See, right here in Numbers, we have the prophet of prophets. We have the man of God who is potentially overlooking a sweet tooth. See, what had happened is that Mr. Bilam, he went to the Lord the first time. And he said, Lord, can I go and do what they're asking me to do? And God clearly said no. Have you ever got a no from God? A nice, firm no? Then he was like, man, but they coming back, and they got bigger purses this time. At first, they were talking about 30 pieces of silver. Now they talking about 300. Instead of 1,000, now they talking about 1,000,000. It's a couple of more digits added on to it. So I know that you are God of your word and everything is yes and amen. I know that you are a God of your word and you are not man that you should lie. But maybe, just maybe, I need to come back to you this second time just in case this is the one time that you do change your mind. See, his willingness to seek God out, if he changed his mind, showed a weakness. Somebody say a weakness. It showed a sweet tooth. See, he knew that God was yes and amen, but he went there to see if he could get him to just change his mind this one time. See, he had a small itch right there, and there was only one thing that could actually scratch it, and that was money. Somebody say, for the love of money. It was the only thing that could scratch that itch. He weakened his will to resist it because he figured it would be no harm in asking God a second time, Lord, can I do this? See, Numbers 22, it doesn't give you the full backstory to Bilam. It doesn't give you all of the color that goes into his narrative. But if you go into different chapters, there's other Bible authors that kind of like outlines it. Like in 2 Peter, it says that Bilam, he loves to earn money by doing the wrong thing. He loved to earn money for telling people what they wanted to hear. So in this case, we could look at Balaam and we could say, shame on you, you man of God. Why are you doing this? Why are you starting down that road and all of that? But if I could be honest, if we could be honest, how many times has God told you to do something? You clearly saw it in his word. You had somebody to prophetically get all up in your business, and you had no idea who they were, but you still told your friend, well, I need to pray about it. Am I by myself? I need to pray about it. Why? Because we know what we want to do. Is there anyone out there that can agree with me that sometimes God tells you things to do that you really don't want to do? I ain't got a couple of people. Can I talk to the back? Can y'all agree with me that sometimes God asks you to do stuff that you don't want to do? He tells you to go down this road, but your preference is to go down this other road. He told you to go to this place, but you actually want to go to the other place. How many times has God tried to interrupt your, he's had the audacity to interrupt your plans with his plans? See, we already had the plans. We had the place picked out. We had the car picked out. We know the color. We know the brand. We know the dealership. We did all of the consumer reviews. We know exactly what we need to do. Matter of fact, we picked out the dress, too. We said yes to the dress. We put down the deposit on the venue. But yet and still, the Lord wants to tell me, and dead in the middle of my premarital counseling, that this is not the route that I'm supposed to go? Lord, how dare you? How many times has he given us clear words to follow, but it's an internal human voice that draws you to the place of doubting the veracity of what you receive? Is it you discerning, or is it you conjuring up an excuse to do what you actually want to do? Is it you trying to keep your options open, or is it you trying to justify your will on top of his will? I'm talking to myself for a second. Is it just me? But sometimes God lays things out there for me, and I'm not really feeling, I'm not picking up what he's putting down. And I'm saying, Lord, I've seen this in the past, and why can't I go this road? Sometimes we ask the question, well, why can't I? Won't you still bless it? Many times we don't want to hear the truth, but what we're looking for is to have a validation to do exactly what we desire to do in the first place. It's easy for people to be convinced to go down a path when you're already looking that direction. See, Balaam, he was faithful to reject the worldly desires at first. He was faithful to be consecrated before God and spend time with him and to receive from the Lord and not to disobey for riches in the past. However, by agreeing to ask God again, after already knowing his will for his life, he revealed a secret desire for rewards. It was a predisposition to have money. Instead of ending all negotiations, he kept going for it. I believe this, that majority of the time, we're in the same situation where we want to follow God. We want to do exactly what he's called us to do. But it's something in our heart that is potentially keeping us from doing what God has called us to do. And that is that blind spot. That is that secret desire. That is that proclivity. That is that hidden fault that's in our hearts. Here we go. Psalms 19 and 12 through 13. It says it like this. This is David speaking. He says, how can I know all of the sins lurking in my heart? Cleanse me from this hidden faults. Keep your servant from deliberate sins. Don't let them control me. Then I will be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. Notice that David did not say, Lord, are there hidden sin in my heart? He didn't say that. He says, how can I know all of the sins lurking in my heart? See, the Bible says that all have sin and fallen short of the glory of God? Can we take off our halo? Can we put our titles to the side? Can I stop being Pastor Christian for a second and say, I have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God? And sometimes, just sometimes, there's still some hidden faults in my heart. I'm thinking of like a honey. I told you I got a sweet tooth. Yeah, anybody got that little honey jar that's in the shape of a bear? The little honey jar. It makes some noise if you got some. Okay, you got some honey people. You tear that biscuit wide open, you lay the butter on top, and then you start pouring that honey on that biscuit, and then you start smash. But uh-oh, I'm not getting everything in there because it is stuff left up in the smile of the bear. You know, it has ripples in the bottom of the container, and I'm trying to get all the honey out. I believe our heart is just like that. I know your ambition and your prayer was that, Lord, empty me out. Whatever grieves you, take it out of me. And this is God trying to cleanse you out, but still it's some stuff in the crevices of your heart. Sometimes it's some bitterness still inside of that container. Sometimes it's the lust of the flesh. It's the pride of life. It is the lust of the eye still caught up inside of your container. So who can understand and know my heart? Those sins that are still stuck up in there. See, here's the deal is that we're talking about King David. He wrote this out. This is King David, the one that says that God said that this is a man after my own heart. So King David, while he was out there and he was consulting God each and every day, and he would dance undignified and from the presence of the Lord, one day he woke up and he planned to sleep with a woman and have her husband killed. It was something still in the crevices of his heart. It was still something in the crevices of his heart. See, the heart for us is like a womb for a woman. If it can be conceived in your heart, it will be birthed through your flesh. See, this is why David could consult the Lord and do all of that, but still set it up where he will sleep with a woman and kill the husband. This is how we can have pastors in an effective mega church that is reaching nations, but then get caught up in scandal. This is why you can have kingdom-minded politicians who has every good intention when they get in office to do the work of the kingdom, but then their career goes sour because they get caught up in the trinity of deception. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. I bring this out because I'm not knocking the mega pastor. I'm not knocking the politician, but I'm simply trying to show you it does not matter what platform we own, we all dealing with sin. We all jacked up. We all got something that we have not totally dealt with. And it's only when we deal with those proclivities, it's only when we deal with how we're leaning, that God will be able to straighten out our visual sight. What is not revealed cannot be healed. What is not revealed and exposed to the Lord cannot be properly dealt with. The only way that infection will no longer go to the rest of my mouth is if the x-ray happened and she removed the infection. So what am I trying to tell you? It's a cancer that's inside of you that you don't even know about. My God. It's a cancer that's inside of you that you don't even know about, but you need to deal with it today in order for it not to spread throughout your body and the rest of the family. So this is what I believe. Is that this is not a one-person thing. This is an all-person thing. And I believe that it falls into three different areas. I already spoke to it before: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. If you want to see the scripture that is referenced as far as those three things for the new believers, you can go to 1 John 2:15 through 17, and it lays it out. But what I do want to show you real fast, I want to throw a couple of things up on the screen. I just got a few minutes left, but I want to throw a couple of things up on the screen just so you can see that, oh man, maybe I just do have some hidden faults. I didn't know that. Okay, so I'm going to show you a couple of buckets. The first one, lust of the eyes. Somebody say the lust of the eyes. Anything that's good to your eyes. That's what we're talking about, greed. So it's a desire to have what other people have. You got that car? I want that car. You got that house? I want that house. Stinginess or hoarding. I put a D at the end of that, just so you know. Stinginess or hoarding. Collecting a whole bunch of stuff that you don't need. And if somebody asks you if they could have some, you're probably going to say, no, I don't have anything to spare. Because you don't want to lie to them. You just said, no, I don't have anything to spare. Selfishness, unwillingness to share. Envy, desiring what other people's have. Laziness and slothfulness. You believe that the world owes you something. The reason why you don't show up to work on time, because they owe you something. I got to deal with this mess that you got, that I got going on here. You lucky that I was just 5 minutes late. You better get your lazy butt to work on time. Shoo. Impatience is for the lust of the eyes. We want stuff right now. What is that one commercial where it says, I want my money and I need it now? We are a now type people, and this is how we disguise it. We say, Lord, I know that you are God of a suddenly. So show up today, this moment, right while I'm talking. You better sit your impatient self down. How many times have God came suddenly in the Bible? I believe the Israelites were in bondage for 400 years. It was supposed to take them 40 days to get out of Egypt, to get to the promised land, and they kept being stubborn. I'm getting ahead of myself. They kept being stubborn, and it took them even longer. And patience. I got it too, y'all. I got it too. I'm a microwave type guy. Look, I put everything in the microwave. Everything. Man, if I could bake some bread, I'll put it in the microwave. Lust of the flesh. Anything that's good to the taste or touch. Unhealthy eating and eating disorders. Why are you stepping on my toe? I like my Snickers, my cakes and pies. You can't control your appetite. It's some people that did not participate in the fast when we just did it because we can't keep our appetite in control. The Bible says that it's certain type of faith that only come by prayer and fasting. Can you understand the faith is not inside of you because you desire a pork chop more than you desire the presence of God? Okay, I'm moving on. All right. Unhealthy and ungodly sexuality. Sexual fantasies of a teenager boy. You are 55 years old. I need for you to grow up. Get your hormones in check. Stop looking at that woman like that. Stop looking at that man like that. I'm moving on. Unhealthy alcohol and drug usage. I know the state of Illinois says that is okay. But the last time I'm checked, that we are foreigners and we're just passing through. My citizenship is not in the city of Chicago. It's not in the city of Crown Point. But my citizenship is of the kingdom. And what does the kingdom say? Moving on. The pride of life. Craving for attention. Craving for position. Craving for authority. Craving for identity. Craving for appreciation. We get into places where we look for people to affirm us. But God has been trying to affirm you a long time ago. You are already qualified. He has not designed you where you're looking for something because he's already placed it inside of you. The pride of life. the pride of life. These three buckets right here, I believe, and I don't want you to say nothing, okay? But I believe that we could probably find something, even if it's not on the screen, that we could point to and resonate with and say, you know what? Maybe I do have some proclivities in my heart. Maybe I do have a bend that's not towards God, but it's towards my priorities. Maybe I have a bend that is not totally in line with what God has called me to. And this, my friends, is what I'm telling you, is that those are the lens that we have to throw to the side in order for us to truly see what God has for us. Here's the warning, is that we must stop ourselves from making the subtle compromises before it costs us the promise. We have to stop backing up before we wind up backsliding. And I say that with a very subtle way. This is not everybody's story, but you can see here for Balaam, it was his story. It just took him questioning God a couple of times for him to end up being the person who was a prophet for hire. He wound up no longer being a prophet of God, but he was a hireling. He was a prophet whore. Anybody that would pay the right price for him, he would say whatever they wanted him to say. And he slipped away from the presence of God because he wanted the pocketbook. And that was because he kept questioning God and his will. See, the more that we question God's will, the more questionable we will live. The more we question God's will, the more questionable we will live. This is how hot Christians become lukewarm Christians. And this is how lukewarm Christians just become cold. This is how we slip away from the presence of God when we start doing things that we're not supposed to do. So we must be willing to extract our secret desires and constantly kill our proclivities. We must die to ourselves daily. Let us not be the believers that lead a couple's crew on Tuesday, but have an inappropriate conversation with somebody else on Thursday that's not my husband, that's not my wife. We must be willing to extract our secret desires. Let us not be the believers who are encouraging teenagers on Wednesday to stay pure, to stay abstinent, to do the things and give themselves to God, and they're giving themselves to somebody else on Friday while they're receiving warm receptions of same-sex attraction. And then we use God's word to justify it. So this is our encouragement, is that God has called us to be hot. God has called us to something, to stay on this path, but we must be willing to resist the devil, because the devil will flee. All right, just got a couple of more minutes. I'm going to hit these two, and then we're going to pray if I can. Number one that I want to make sure that we hear this morning is that our resistance is limiting your visual distance. The problem is that we're resisting God. The problem for Balaam is that he kept resisting God. He kept asking questions he wasn't supposed to ask. He was beating a donkey that was trying to get his attention. God is so cool because he is a loving father. He is a good father. Any empty nesters out there, you got some adult kids, make some noise out there. You guys are so seasoned. I know that y'all could really agree with what I'm saying, is that as an empty nester, and when you talk to your children that are adults, it's only so much you can tell them. Then it's up to them. They grown men, they grown women. So all you can do is try to steer them the right way, and then the rest is up to them. God is the same exact way. He is not gonna force his will on you, but if we keep resisting his will, that will mess up our spiritual visuals, and we won't be able to understand and see what's ahead of us. God, he opened up Balaam's eyes the moment that he stopped resisting. The moment that the donkey looked up at him and said, hey, we've been rocking for a long time. When's the last time that I'll talk to you like this? When's the last time I ever talked to you? He said, have I ever done this before? That's what the donkey said. And he had to look at that donkey and said, no. That was the moment that he stopped resisting. And that's when God opened up his eyes. The donkey was able to see things that he could not see because of his heart. The purity of his heart. He wasn't going to get anything out of it. He was just happy for the water and hay that he got. He wasn't going to get anything else out of it. What am I trying to say? I think it's people around you that's acting as donkeys, and they're trying to give you some good counsel, but you are treating them like dumb animals. If I was a cusser, I would use a different word. If I was a cusser, I would use another word. It's people around you that's trying to give you red flags. God has placed them inside of your circle for a reason, but you keep looking at them as dumb donkeys. But their hearts are pure. When is the last time that they went up against you? When is the last time that they told you no? When is the last time that they said, no, don't go that way? But you're looking at them as dumb donkeys. Our kids, so pure heart. When's the last time that they looked at that, looked at a guy and said, nah, mama, I don't know about him. Nah, mama, your social media, I don't know, mama. When the last time that their pure heart actually gave you some pushback? So God, he's a good father. And he won't yell at you. He won't force you to do his will. But he'll give you a whole bunch of caution tape. It's time for us to stop resisting. Stop resisting. Stop pushing. God is trying to get close to us, and we keep pushing away. I want to say this last thing, and then we're going to stand, and then I want to pray for us, if we could pray for us, because I need the prayer as well. The last thing is that we need to learn to close the door of opportunity. It says, resist the devil and he shall flee. The reason why it feels good and it sounds good and it tastes good because you keep dabbling with it. But at some point, we got to wake up and we got to just close that door. We got to close the door. I'll give you a quick story about myself, my own personal testimony. Some people may know this about me already, before I came to Anthem, I was in corporate America. Climbed up the ladder a little bit, got to middle management. At the same time, my wife and I were looking for some entrepreneurial opportunities, looking at different franchises, and it was cool. And a couple of things failed. It was one that was really sticking to us. It was like the franchise of franchises. You know what I'm saying? It was the franchise of quick service. You look at that brand, it's like, yes, that is it. I was in the process for 2.5 years, but I'll be very honest, I was in the process for 1.5 years too long. About the 1 year mark, God told me to get out the process. He told me to get out. Honest to God, I told my wife this, but what happened is that I went back to him and said, Lord, are you sure? Because in my mind, I clothed it, I packaged it as, Lord, you want me to be financially independent. Lord, well, wouldn't it be amazing if I walk into full-time ministry and they don't have to give me a paycheck, but I could have this money already? And I came up with these great excuses, great things, good things, but was it godly? Was it godly? So that year and a half went by, and it was 2.5, 3 years. Right at the end, I got the phone call after the 9th interview, traveling back and forth, and it said, no, you did not get it. It broke my little heart. But God had to remind me, son, I told you to get out a long time ago. And the reason why he had me to get out, or why he wanted me to get out, is because I saw real easily that I would have to go to a place that God wasn't calling me to. Geographically, go to a place that he wasn't calling me to. He also showed me that, hey, this is actually going to have to be your primary, and you won't have time for ministry. And you won't have time for what I've actually called you to do. But I kept it as a door of opportunity because I didn't want to burn a bridge. Can I tell you today, burn the bridge. Burn it. Burn it. If I could give you some wisdom today, It's going to save you time, and it's going to save you some hurt feelings. I wasted time pursuing something that I wasn't supposed to be pursuing in the first place. And it absolutely hurt my feelings. This is not a salvation issue. This is a purpose issue. This is God optimizing you and calling you to some great things and some amazing things. But if we don't look at this with the right set of eyes, if we allow the proclivities of our heart, because down in my heart, I wanted the bag. I wanted the bag, y'all. It would be absolutely amazing for me to be like, oh, I'm an owner of this brand. I'm a franchisee of this brand. They look at you, oh. This is me being honest. If I could really dive deep into it and get to the corners of that honey bottle, the issue is that I was looking at the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, and I wasn't focused in on God. I believe that all of us have that checkpoint in our lives. I'm hoping, I'm putting myself out. I believe that all of us have that checkpoint in our lives to say that, you know what? Yes, something that's messing up my vision right now. Whether it's warranted or not warranted. If you put it there or somebody else put it there, there's some brokenness that's still there that's distorting my vision. Can you go and stand to your feet? I just want to pray for us. If that's you, can I pray for you? Can you lift your hands right where you are? My question is, what are the conversations that you need to stop having with God? What are the doors that you need to close and close for good? Because it's not what God has for you. Father, come to us now and extract. Right now, we're not resisting you, but we are opening up. Lord, you do heart surgery here in the name of Jesus. Lord, we want to die to our flesh. We want to die to every lust that's trying to keep us from your presence, to keep us from the plan that you have for us. We say right now, let not our will be done, but let your will be done. So, Father, once and for all, continue to keep us open. Continue to remove the stuff that ain't supposed to be there. Tomorrow, we're going to pray the same prayer, Lord, because it's new mercies for us tomorrow. But Father, we want to die to you daily so our vision don't get messed up. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. All right, let's give God a big shout of praise in the place. Pastor Isaac is coming now to end us.
Amen. Let's give it up for that word one more time. Weren't you blessed? All right. All of our first-time guests, let's make some noise for them. First-time guests, thank you so much for joining us today. Make sure you meet us out in the lobby. Remember, membership class is happening at 12 p.m. today. So if you want to join the church, meet us in the grill room at 12 o'clock. Our For the 219 team is outside. If you want any information about joining For the 219, won't you raise your hands for the blessing? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. Now, Anthem family, we send you out of this place to go and lead people to know Christ and make him known. If you need prayer, our prayer team is here at the foot of the stage. If not, we'll see you next week. God bless.